Detroit, I forgot already. I don't see it.
What's that, sir?
What's the one in Detroit?
MJ.
I
We are looking for people who are willing to serve as liturgists, greeters, and ushers over these next few months. If you feel like one of those jobs is something you'd be willing to try, please speak with me after service or call the office during the week. Wednesday Night Live resumes on Wednesday. That's January 18th, this Wednesday. And today, from 2 to 4, you're invited to come help your pastor study for his ordination exams. If you're wondering, I am ordained, but I'm ordained United Methodist, and the presbytery of the Presbyterian Church has approved me to be a pastor and to serve this church, but I got to pass the ordination exams to stay here. And one of those exams is on Bible content, so we're just going to have a little bit of fun and do some Bible trivia this afternoon. All ages, you can't know too little Bible. Just come have fun. Bring a snack to share and make it a fun time of fellowship. And last but not least, I just want to warn you that today's opening hymn is going to sound a lot like last week's and a lot like next week's. We sang a new song last week, and we're going to go ahead and sing it this week and next week, not because we're never singing another hymn again, but because we're going to learn that hymn and spend a little time with it for a couple weeks. With that, I invite us to turn our attention to God with this morning's prelude.
Thank you. We gather for a worship as a people who seek God in our lives. We stray and we run away.
Yet our God chooses us over and over. Our God loves us completely.
God's love for us knows no bounds, and God chooses to be with us.
May we feel God's presence as we worship today.
Let us pray. O gracious and holy God, give us diligence to seek you, wisdom to perceive you, and patience to wait for you. Give us, O God, a mind to meditate on you, eyes to behold you, ears to listen for your word, a heart to love you, and a life to proclaim you. Help us to be especially aware of your presence during worship today. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Please stand in body or spirit as you are able to sing our opening hymn.
Thank you.
I'm not quite sure which microphones are going to work, and so they're all on and we'll just see. The psalmist writes, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts." May we earnestly invite God to search and to know our hearts, that we would confess earnestly our sin before God. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Let us share God's peace with one another.
Blessed are your words, Jesus is God.
my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest, I in my Savior.
Invite us all to turn in our bulletins to the announcement page where you will see a list of prayer concerns. We continue to pray for Reverend Daniel as she travels through the Holy Land, although at this point I believe she is probably back in the U.S. with family, but getting ready to travel home. My wife and I asked for prayers for our family. My mother-in-law has not been well for a number of years now. She's been battling stage 4 cancer, and the medicines have held it at bay for quite some time, but things have taken a turn, and that's where we were this last week for a few days, and we're going to have quite a bit of travel coming up as we say goodbye to her and as we spend time together and as family. So we just ask for your prayers for that. Are there, in addition to those that are printed, are there any additional prayer concerns to lift up this morning? Okay, now you know me by now. It's okay if we don't have any other concerns, but surely amongst all these people, we can come up with at least one what? One joy.
Gary is home after 2 weeks.
And how is he feeling now?
He put a sock on for the first time.
He put a sock on! I think there's a joke in there somewhere about putting a sock in it, but yeah. Putting a sock on is a big deal after a back surgery. We know, yes. Any other joys? All right, let us. Oh, yes, James. Your chickens have survived the winter so far. Awesome. I'm not sure if our bees have survived. Okay, but if they have, you'll have to come over and see them sometime, okay? Check. Let us turn our hearts and minds to God as we join together in an attitude of prayer. Dear Lord, as we gather here together as your people, we gather together as a people of prayer. A people who, yes, lift our voices up individually
for those things upon our hearts, but also as a people who join with one another, lifting our prayers up in unison as one gathered congregation, as one community of faith. Not because we lack the faith to believe that you already have heard the prayer, but because when we join together in prayer, something happens within our community. And by praying to you, something happens between us and you, our God. We pray that you would be with those who are struggling this week. You would be with those who find themselves feeling alone or feeling disconnected. And we pray for those who find themselves traveling or beyond the place that they call home, that you would continue to be a felt presence in their lives. In your holy and blessed name we pray. And we pray as you taught us to pray, using whatever words we best know it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. You know, I have for weeks now congratulated myself after worship that I said debt and debtors until this week. But I did say, all of us should say it in the words we best know, right? So I'm okay this week.
Today's scripture for today's lesson comes from John chapter 1. The next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God." The next day John was again with two of his disciples, and when he saw Jesus passing by, he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, I know some of you have been going back to school for a little while, and some of you just went back this past week, and some of you are in preschool, and some of you are in grade school, and some of you are in junior high, but my question is, what is your favorite subject? James? Long division. You like math. How about you, Anna? What do you like? Social studies. What do you like, Henry? Do you like recess? What's your favorite, Elizabeth?
I like
language, arts, and history. Be proud of these guys. Nobody said recess or lunch. I think my favorite time in grade school was when we did show and tell, because then I could show something and tell about it that I was really passionate about. The Bible tells us that a man named John also loved to show and tell others about Jesus. The Bible says that one day John was standing with a group of people when he saw Jesus coming. And what did he say? "Look, there is the..." Nope. "Lamb of God. Look, there is the Lamb of God." And he said that he's the one that takes away the sins of the world. "I have seen him, and I tell you that this is the Son of God." Because John loved to show and tell others about Jesus, many people came to know Jesus and follow him. Now, it's important for you and me to show and tell others about Jesus, too. What can we do to show and tell others about Jesus? How about showing kindness? How about showing compassion? How about loving one another? Those are all things that show people that we know Jesus and we love Jesus. And then people will see that we know Jesus, and then they'll give us a chance We can tell them about what he's done for us and about what he wants to do for them. Let us pray. Dear Father, help us this week to show and tell others about you and your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining me.
May I just say that, you know, when it's my own kid and I see them run around or make a little noise or whatever, my heart starts beating a little extra fast. Some of you parents probably know that feeling of, When I'm in church, besides when it's my own kid, when I'm in church and I see those little feet, I couldn't see it from back there. Several little feet that were just going like this in the pew the whole time, and to hear the little pitter-patter up and down the pews, and to hear the bits of noise from the sanctuary, it just wouldn't be church if we didn't hear that bit of joyous racket that comes from the most special people among us. I adore it. Would you please be in an attitude of prayer as we prepare ourselves for this morning's scripture? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Today's scripture comes from Isaiah 41, verses 8 through 10. And as is my custom, I'm reading from the Common English Bible. But you, Israel, my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, offspring of Abraham, whom I love, you, whom I took from the ends of the earth and called from its furthest corners, saying to you, you are my servant. I chose you. I didn't reject you. Don't fear, because I am with you. Don't be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will surely help you. I will hold you with my righteous and strong hand. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
If I know that someone is ill, one of the first things as pastor is I try to get a hold of them on the phone, see if they would like to have a visit. Pastoral visits are one of the key things that a pastor does in ministry. Am I right? When we know that someone is not feeling well, the idea that the pastor is off sitting with them and visiting with them gives all of us just a little extra comfort, I think. I was the pastor at Hudson United Methodist Church for a few years, and I thought I did a pretty good job of going out and visiting. And I got an angry call from the adult child of one of my parishioners. Hilda was the parishioner's name. Hilda was in the process of dying. She was confined to her chair, she was coughing, she couldn't catch her breath, and life was tough for Hilda. I have a question for you. How many pastoral visits would be enough to make Hilda feel better? How many? There's no number we can put on Hilda's pain, on what Hilda was going through. I was able to say, when the son called, I was able to say, well, you know, I was just out there 2 weeks ago. I was out a week before that, and I'm making this up. You know what I'm saying. I was able to tell him all of the these times that I had visited just recently. But when I went home and talked to my wife said, it doesn't matter, Scott. It doesn't matter how often you visited Hilda. She's in pain, and she's feeling alone. This is one of those times when saying that God is here, God is present, God is with you, Hilda, probably would have rung a little bit hollow. I think about the many times I've said that. I've left somebody their bedside or praying with them, and I've said, just know that God is with you. And then I think back to my own time in the hospital and how alone I felt at some moments when I was in the hospital. What about the person who's had no contact with family while they've been slowly losing a battle with a communicable disease, maybe? Well, what about the person who just wants to go home and can't accept that they are now living in a nursing home? What about the person who's watching their loved ones slip away into dementia? There's no number of pastoral visits that can fix any of that pain. God is with you. Might seem to ring hollow when we are in one of those positions. But today's scripture, we turn to Isaiah. And in Isaiah 41, Isaiah is speaking for God. That means, listen carefully, that means that God, yes, God spoke to Isaiah. Isaiah had a revelation of God. God was present with Isaiah. Isaiah experienced God in a very special way. But God's message, God's presence was not just for Isaiah, was it? It was for the whole people. God spoke through Isaiah to an entire community. God's presence was not just for one person. It was for a community of people. Community of Israel. What I love about Presbyterianism, one of the many things, is our deacons program. Because at its heart, the deacon program recognizes there's no way for any one pastor to do enough visiting in certain circumstances. There's no way for any one of us to do enough visiting. But God is present with our community. God is present with our church. God is present with our deacons so that then we can be present with others. I was telling Kay what I love about the deacon program as I'm getting to know it better and better is the way in which I'll hear from people, I'll hear from deacons who say that they went out to visit someone. And then when I talk to the person they were visiting, I learn that they say, well, and my former deacon was by just the other day. And then they'll say, there was this person who used to be a deacon, an active deacon on the board of deacons. And they just called me and checked in on me, and someone else brought me cookies. And what I began to realize is the deacon program, it creates a web of God's grace around this congregation. It's not just one deacon going out and visiting one person. It's not about the pastor going out and visiting one person. It's about creating a complex web of love around a congregation so that we're all taking turns visiting and connecting and loving each other. And it's contagious, because the more I talk to people who are stuck in their home or dealing with grief or hurting in some other way, the more I speak with them, the more I come to realize that it's not just the deacons who are doing this work. This kind of work is contagious. And people begin to feel as though they have been surrounded by God's grace, even if they can't put those words to it. God isn't just speaking to Isaiah when God says, "Do not fear, I am with you. Don't be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will surely help you. I will hold you with my righteous strong hand." And that ministry begins as Isaiah says the words to Israel. It continues as the people surround each other in love and learn to be a more godly people time and time again. And for us as First Presbyterian Church of Galesburg, Illinois, we can do the same thing. When we hold these words that were first spoken to Isaiah, that apply to Isaiah's people, they are also spoken to us. They also apply to our people. "Do not fear, because I am with you. Don't be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will surely help you. I will hold you with my righteous strong hand." When a person is feeling broken or alone, we can know that God is with them. We can pray that they will feel God's presence, and I surely do. But then we go out and take turns being with them so that they can experience God's presence in that kind of way as well. When we realize that people in our community are struggling, we can know that they are children of God, and we can know that God is with them. We can pray that they will experience God and know God's presence, and we surely do. And then we use our resources to go out alongside of God and do God's holy work right next to God. And when we ourselves, or a family member, or a dear friend, when we are alone and we are hurting, yes, let us turn to God and know that God loves us and know that God is present. I pray that we would look for that right in this space, right in the moment, and know that our God is with us. Let us pray that we would feel God's presence. And then call your pastor, your deacon, your church, and let them know what you're feeling. Because we want to surround each other in a web of grace, God's grace, that we would all experience that connectedness. Because God is with us. And by the way, so are the people of First Presbyterian Church. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and all those who live in it. With gladness, let us present the offerings of our life and labor to the Lord.
Thank you.
Gracious God, everything we have comes from you. You fill us with good things. Our hearts and lives overflow with your abundance. With thanksgiving, we bring to you our time, talents, and tithes. Use these gifts that you have given us to feed others as we have been fed, to serve others as we have been served, and to bless others as we have been blessed. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please stand in body or spirit as you are able to sing our closing hymn.
It's meant to be a reminder that God is present with us as a community. God is also present with us throughout our lives, whatever we're going through, whatever we're experiencing, whatever difficulty or joy has presented itself. Our God is there with us, present and loving. Let us join together as we sing our closing benediction.